one is posterior canal reconstruction and the other is lateral intact bridge mastoidectomy. All these techniques work very well indeed, and I must explain to you the logic of it. What are the principles of treatment of cholesteatoma? A cholesteatoma is just an epithelial cyst of the mastoid. Squamous epithelium must be excised in toto or exteriors. Now, for example, if you have a huge invasive cholesteatoma, in the old days there was no way you could really remove it, that way you used an open cavity. Nowadays, it's possible to remove all the cholesteatoma without any epithelium remaining, and therefore you can have an intact canal wall. No cavity problems remain. Another important principle that has not often been underlined in most places, mucosa also must be excised in toto or interiorized, that means put into communication with the eustachian tube. Now here is a blocked eustachian tube. And because the eustachian tube is blocked, there is no aeration to the mucosa. Unaerated mucosa will secrete mucus, and there you have got serous otitis media. Now, the same thing happens if you have well-pneumatized mastoid. Here is an open cavity. If you give an open cavity in a well-pneumatized mastoid, what happens? When the squamous epithelium lines the cavity, there is no way the mucosal cells will aerate. And therefore, unaerated mucosa will secrete mucosa. It's not infection. It is unaerated mucosa that's secreting, and therefore you have cavity problems and discharge. Another thing that's not very often taught is the VA upon S ratio. The volume of air circulating in the ear and the surface area of the skin of the ear canal must be reasonable. If there is a meatostenosis, narrow ear canal, you have to do a meatoplasty or meatoconcoplasty. It's a huge cavity, you can do a muscle obliteration. But it's not all that simple. See, this is a muscle obliteration. How do you do muscle obliteration? Any squamous epithelium remaining in the mastoid, if it's buried, you'll get late intracranial complications. If there's a well-pneumatized mastoid and you bury the mucosa of the outlying mucosal line cells, you get this, they'll secrete mucosa and you get pain and discharge. So that is not the answer. In order to find a better solution, Janssen and Chi describe posterior tympanotomy and combined approach tympanoplasty. But that is not a good thing for the simple reason, it is a low dura, there's not enough space. Therefore you cannot remove all the squamous epithelium and you might get a residual cholesteatoma. If you have not been able to arrange a nice path of aeration, you get a retraction pocket. There's a recurrent cholesteatoma. So what is my solution? Lateral intact bridge mastoidectomy. The combined approach of So, if you have preserved the posterior canal wall, there is not enough excess. If you don't have enough excess, you will have residual cholesteatoma. If you have not a good path of aeration, because remember, the tensor tympanum, the head of the malleus, all that is interfering in the path of aeration, and therefore you get a recurrent cholesteatoma. What I do, I remove the entire posterior canal wall, but leave only a 3 millimeter rim. Therefore, this rim is so thin that it cannot conceal any cholesteatoma. Here, you can see all the way, by the way, this is the mini end of incision also. Huh? You can see all the way into the attic. Then all this is completely clean. And here's a classic two cartilage technique. One cartilage from the depression in the inferior aneurysm to the head of the stapes. Second cartilage for pressure contact, and it prevents the fascia from falling into the mastoid. So this, and all this is lined with silastic. Therefore, path of aeration is excellent. You will not get either a residual or a recurrent cholesteatoma. This is how it looks. See, this thin posterior canal wall, 3 millimeters. It cannot conceal any disease at all. See, it's like that. This is the path of aeration, huge path of aeration lined with sialastic. This is the stapes, and this is the sialastic lining the mastoid. Here is a two cartilage technique again, from the depression in the inferior annulus to the head of the stapes, second cartilage for pressure contact, and see this sialastic lining aeration path to the round window and to the mastoid. So with the CIT you get narrow access and residual disease, poor aeration, late retraction, and thick posterior canal wall can hide a cholesteatoma. With my technique, lateral IBM, 3 millimeter posterior canal wall, wide access, pincer and head of the malleus cut off, they were medium posterior canal wall removed, and you got good aeration, and thin posterior canal wall, cholesteatoma can bulge through. There's no risk of the cholesteatoma going up into the brain. Now this is a posterior canal reconstruction. Here is an open cavity, nicely done, but residual mucosa. Unaerated mucosa is going to secrete mucus and this is discharging cavity. So what do you do for that? Posterior canal wall has been removed, so what do? Reconstruct it. This is a reconstructed posterior canal wall. See, a cartilage goes from a depression in the inferior annulus to the head of stapes, second cartilage for pressure contact, third cartilage. From here, it supports the musculoperiosteal flap and prevents them from falling into the mastoid. Suppose you allow them to fall into the mastoid, unaerated mucosa of some residual cells will secrete mucus. But here you have a sialastic line path of aeration, and this musculoperiosteal flap has supported. They are not going to fall into the mastoid. They are not obliterating. They are creating posterior canal, and you are reconstructing the posterior canal wall. See, this is how it looks like. First cartilage for head of stapes is the second cartilage for pressure contact, third cartilage for posterior canal reconstruction, and this muscle is being shifted in so that posterior canal wall is reconstructed. See, excellent path of aeration. This is how it looks at the as healed. See, very thin posterior canal wall. It's so thin. This is the first cartilage to head of stapes, the second cartilage for pressure contact, and just see, it's so thin. You cannot imagine that cholesteatoma can grow behind this and go into the brain. This is how it looks like, posterior canal wall. So indications for posterior canal reconstruction, difficult anatomy and pathology, discharging open cavity. Contraindications, blocked eustachian tube, large labyrinthine fistula. If it's a large labyrinthine fistula, you try and remove the squamous epithelium from that, you're risking a danger. Therefore, it would have to be done at the second stage, and the risk of residual disease. In such cases, we recommend FISH, extended mastoid epitympanectomy. What are the advantages? Complete clearance of diseases, visualization is complete after clearing the posterior canal. No risk of recurrent cholesteatoma. Mucosa is aerated down the eustachian tube, therefore no risk of residual mucosa giving problems. Adequate reservoir of air is maintained. If you do an obliteration, then there is no reservoir of air remaining. Here there is a good reservoir of air behind the reconstructed posterior canal wall. And one shot healing. You operate today, next day can go. The patient may go to any place by trade. He's seen again in 6 weeks, he's completely healed. Extensive use of cartilage keeps middle ear air space aerated. No risk of extrusion because patient's own cartilage. We don't use titanium or gold or What are the principles? Skin can only grow from skin. Skin deficit will cause granulations. Raw areas of will granulate. Granulation is what? Fibroblasts and capillaries. When the fibroblasts turn into fibrocytes, they contract. Healing should be by primary intention, not granulation. How can you secure healing by primary intention? Line everything with skin. Large raw areas must be crafted, and small raw areas you can cover with Teflon or silastic. If lateral IBM is not possible, posterior canal reconstruction must be done. Skin grafts over raw areas. Here is the posterior canal reconstruction.
Sir, I am in conference.
And all raw areas are covered with skin.
Sir, I am in conference in Jaipur.
Second principle is mucosa can only grow from mucosa. Silastic must be used, gel film, Teflon. I use gel film more often than not because silastic can exude. Yeah? Even after 5 years of the operation, if the patient develops sinusitis and blows the nose hard, you can get extrusion of silastic. But gel film gets absorbed in 14 days time. And nowadays, mostly I use only gel film. Now what about ossicular reconstruction? If the stapes superstructure is present, intact and mobile, this type 3 is a not good idea. You see, now just think, if this fascia adheres to a raw area on the fascia or on the promontory, there's no way air can pass to the area between the crura. Late necrosis of the crura will occur. If you have a type 3 and for some reason or other the drum detracts away, you get again a residual conductive loss. So I don't believe, as I told you, no malleus stapes assembly, no rigid assembly. No TORP. You see, this is auto malleus, auto incus. If after some raw area is there, if it touches raw area on the facial, you will get adhesions. Lateralization, if the TORP is adherent to this drum and if it detracts outwards, you will get lateralization. It can get displaced, and sometimes there is fistula. Now, I remember there was one lady from England, she was from Kenya. She went to England and got her modified radical mastectomy done. And after the operation, she developed vertigo and progressive deafness. So those people did ENGs and whatnot, and they said, no, this is many years, but I knew what had happened. When I reopened, I found that the entire foot plate had gone into the vestibule. The previous surgeon had put incus on the foot plate, and the whole foot plate had gone to the vestibule, causing SN loss and vertigo. Therefore, this is not a good thing at all. What about type 4? If you can encounter spontaneous type 4 with a good hearing, no need to dismantle, but then automatically you are forced to have an open cavity. You can't have a type 4 and a CAT or a lateral IBM. What if the incus is necrotic? You can put a cartilage from the infraannulus to the incurostabular joint like that. What if the malleus is absent? If you just put a, now in this case the malleus handle is absent and incus and stapes are okay. If you put a graft on the incurostabular joint, it will lateralize away. The hearing will not be good. The only way out is put a cartilage from depression in the inferior canal wall to the incurostabular joint, and the graft is resting on the cartilage, and then you have wonderful results. The advantage of two cartilage ossicloplasty supports the fascia and separates from silastic, maintains aeration path to the mastoid, no extrusion, no lateralization, no bony ankylosis, no foot plate subluxation, and pressure contact. The salient features of our technique are mini end-over incision, just half a centimeter above the triggers. Interlay technique for rubber construction, two cartilage aciculoplasty, quick primary tension healing because raw areas are covered, VA upon S ratio adjusted by neotoplasty, and no open cavity, either lateral IBM or posterior canal reconstruction. These are the problems with open cavity, residual perforation. You can see, you can have residual pathology. See this cholesteatoma remaining. Residual pathology can be either TB also, or foreign body can be, exclude tuberculosis and foreign body. Bad shape, poor meatoplasty. There is unaerated mucosa. This is secreted not because of the infection, but it is not aerated mucosa. So discharged cavity can be avoided by bad VA upon S ratio near to conchoplasty, bad shape, saucerizer, use a diamond drill. Residual perforation, use only interlay technique. Residual mucosa, interlays, either lateral IBM or PCR. Residual disease. If it's cholesteatoma, excise in toto. Granulations should be biopsied and TB should be excluded. This is a bad VA upon S ratio being corrected. Discharging cavity, saucerize, get primary intention healing by skin grafting. If you have done a muscle obliteration not nicely, you can get irregular retraction of obliterative muscleplasty. That must be corrected also, and the best thing in my opinion is posterior canal reconstruction. So avoided an open cavity, lateral IBM for easy access. This is a lateral IBM. See this thin posterior canal wall, 3 millimeters. You cannot imagine that there's any blind spot behind this. See the thin posterior canal wall. Reconstruction with cartilage. See this is a cartilage from the inferior annulus to the head of the stapes. There's a hole in it. So if the anatomy and pathology is such that complete removal of the cholesteatoma is possible, an intact canal wall technique is best, lateral IBM. If the anatomy is difficult or the pathology is extensive, posterior canal reconstruction is best. If the eustachian tube is blocked, a fish mastoidoepididymectomy is performed. In case of a large labyrinth and fistula and a well-numerous mastoid, second look after lateral IBM. Thank you very much.